Meghan, welcome to Landscape Photography World. How are you going?
I am going good, thanks, Grant. Thanks so much for inviting me to be on the show.
Thank you for agreeing to be on the show. It's wonderful to have you here. I've definitely been a follower of yours for some time and really admire your work. Why don't you talk to me a little bit about why you started in landscape photography in particular, but photography in general as well?
Yeah, so I've got two boys who are teenagers now, and when we were living in Wellington a few years back, picked up a camera really just to start blogging, to take pictures of the kids and to share that with our family who were living sort of 6 or 7 hours drive away and also on the other side of the world. So I would write these weekly blogs and the kids would appear, and quite often we'd be out having little adventures in the around the Wellington region. But I quite quickly came to realise that I actually preferred just taking photos of the landscape. So I could take or leave the photos of the kids, poor children. And yeah, just grew from there really. And I had a job where I had a lot of creative kind of brain space free. And it naturally just morphed into learning a bit more about the landscapes and wanting to just be out in that sort of first moment of sunrise. And yeah, so it was a bit of a progression really over a period of a few years. But yeah, these days I'm lucky if I can ever get a photo of my kids on my phone, and definitely none on my camera. So yeah, natural progression.
Yeah, they tend to shy away from it a little bit later in life. I know I've got albums full of them as babies and all the way up to about 5 or 6,
yeah,
7 or 8, and that's where they start to dodge and weave, yeah, and want to not be a part of the photo.
Totally.
So what place does photography have in your life?
I'm going to say it's not the most important thing, because otherwise my family will kill me. My family's pretty important to me, but photography comes a close second, and that is actually my full-time job. So I guess I'm quite lucky to do something that I love. I've come from out of a role of being a corporate accountant for many years, and a bit of a lifestyle change to go from a very technical number crunching role into something that's a bit more creative. But if I'm honest, I always had some sort of level of creativity, whether it was writing poetry or playing music and things. I kind of fell into the accounting, and I wouldn't say I was a natural accountant. So I think I've always had that creative side. And just picking up a camera and seeing what you could create, and also capturing a moment of when you're out and about in the outdoors. We're so lucky here in New Zealand to have probably, I would argue, the best landscapes in the world when you think about how much variety there is in a small little island nation like we are. So I couldn't have picked a nicer place to want to hone my craft.
Definitely. I think one of the attractions of New Zealand is that it is so compact. You can drive sort of coast to coast, east coast to west coast in a few hours. Try and do that here in Australia, and it's more like a few days or weeks, yep, depending on how you choose to travel. But it's and as you say, the variety is just amazing. So what is it about landscapes, I guess, that you're chasing and motivates you to get out there at silly hours, which was a very common theme for many landscape photographers?
Yeah, I love my sleep. So why I picked a passion that involves the early hours is beyond me. Yeah, I landscapes for me is just, I'm just in my absolute happy place when I'm having adventures, when I'm driving around the country, chasing something you don't even know what you're chasing half the time. You're on your way somewhere and you see a bit of light and you've just got to stop and shoot it because it looks amazing. And it wasn't what you intended to do, but often the journey ends up being better than the destination or what you were headed for. And yeah, over the years, I think that when I first started out in photography, I was about getting the shots and all of the famous spots, the popular spots.
Sure,
and
sure.
Whilst I still do go back to those spots, like for example, Araki, time and time again, these days it's about what can I get that's not the same as what everyone else has. And this moment of light, and I find myself more and more, I used to struggle for using my telephoto lens because I love the big wide landscapes. But over the years, I've tried to force myself to start to hone in on some of those smaller details, because often those can be the images that really speak to people more when there's less going on in the image than everything going on. You can have amazing scenes with lakes and mountains and reflections and cool clouds and trees and everything going on, but sometimes those really small little intimate moments can actually really speak to you more than the grand landscapes do.
I think you're quite right. It's a lot of landscape photography, certainly for me anyway, is about what you don't include as much as what you do.
Yeah.
And
it's quite a hard lesson to learn.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's making those choices. I actually threw something up on Twitter yesterday, which was a shot taken on a 200mm lens. I didn't have my 2x converter, so I couldn't go to 400. Mm. There was a really bright sky above a dark layer of cloud. And so to frame it, I didn't want that bright sky. I wanted the gloominess of the dark cloud. So I ended up with a lot of water in the foreground that I didn't really want the end shot. And I've actually spent the last couple of days just trying to work out how to crop it and leave out what I don't want and keep in what I do. As you say, those decisions that you have to make are really hard. One of the things I'm interested in is what's your thought process when you're going through that decision-making, whether it's in the studio and cropping post-processing or whether it's in the field and trying to frame up the image in the camera.
Yeah. There's definitely an element of getting that framing right in camera, because often that will help so much when it comes to the editing process, particularly around not having distractions. I'm a real proponent of looking through the viewfinder, not just relying on the screen, because the number of times I've been caught out, I'll have shot for 20 minutes, half an hour in a particular place, and then I'll look through my viewfinder and go, oh, I did not see that stick in the corner of the shot. Like, it's been there the whole time.
Yep.
So, yeah, just in terms of, and just making sure that I'm always thinking about what is on the edges of my image. Is it adding or is it detracting? Is there something that's drawing us, the eye into the image? Are there nice leading lines coming in? That sort of thing. I try not to have to crop too much when I'm doing my editing later, but ultimately sometimes you're restricted with your lens choice that you have with you. And so you then have to make the shot work as you might have envisaged it in the field. You might have been there going, actually, I know I'm going to have to crop this because 200 mils is my longest and I cannot get closer, and I know the shot's going to look better when it's cropped. So it's a little bit of both, but I try as much as possible to have the right lens on at the time for the composition, rather than, because I always like to try and keep as much resolution in the shots that I get if I want to sell them, blow them up large.
Yeah, that's always a consideration if you're going to try to sell prints or something and you want to blow it up nice and large. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you set goals in your photography? And if so, how do you go about it?
I definitely have, because obviously I've gone from being a corporate accountant to doing part-time photography to full-time photography. And I wouldn't say it's been a smooth road, because I decided to go full-time just about as COVID hit. Mm-hmm. So I had a few workshops planned that I couldn't do because no one was traveling anywhere. Yeah, I definitely do have goals. I'm a bit of a list writer and a ticker offer of things. So I'm actually in a phase right now over summer where I'm not traveling as much. I try to run most of my workshops and things during the sort of autumn, winter, spring, just because the days aren't quite so long. So I found myself in a position where I'm actually at home for a couple of months, which hardly ever happens. And I've got this big long to-do list of things, like I want to rewrite my landscape photography course online because the content's a couple of years old now. It's really hard to motivate yourself to do those admin jobs, though, because I'd far rather be out shooting. But I have been having to force myself to go, no, you've done a lot this year. Think of all the places you've been and all the things you've done. These things are equally as important. If you give me a choice and the scales are there and they go, you could go out and shoot an amazing sunrise tomorrow, or you can spend 8 hours rewriting module 5 of your course, the trip outdoors is always going to win every single time.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So do you structure projects in terms of, we can talk a little bit more about how you work the business a little bit later. I'm interested, though, in terms of your own personal photography. Do you structure projects around your photography? or are you less of a planner and you're more spontaneous in your shooting?
Yeah, depends on a lot of the time it's quite location specific. So I've got an idea and go, okay, I don't really have much content from, say, I don't know, Northland. I need to plan a trip to Northland, and then what I'll have things I want to tick off. But honestly, landscape photography is 90% frustration and 10% elation. So there's a lot of things on my wish list of places I want to go and the type of shot I've envisaged in my mind that I might be waiting 6 or 7 years to shoot. Things like, I don't know if you're familiar with Mount Taranaki. Yeah, so there's a shot at Cape Egmont, which I finally got sunset, but it was about the fifth time I'd been there over the course of about 4 or 5 years. So a lot of it is just, yeah, having some goals, but also being flexible enough to let other things dip in and dip out. And yeah, there's more I'd love to learn. Like, I've done a lot more in Photoshop recently. I love Lightroom, and I think Lightroom's become more and more like Photoshop. But because I do astro stacking and long exposure foregrounds and things like that, I find in focus stacking, I find myself more and more in Photoshop than what I used to. And I would love to learn more on some of the technical stuff. It hasn't held me back at all, but yeah, I think it's knowledge is power, and I think it's really important to always feel like you've got something else that you could learn rather than thinking it all. I definitely do not know it all. And the thing as well is often with workshops, I find that I'll actually come away learning something from a participant. And I always say to people at the beginning of the workshops, your goal is to teach me something, because I think, you know, it's like you can never be that person who thinks they know everything, because I really don't. And I actually love it when people teach me stuff. I'm all about it. And I think that kind of learning environment, as much as I'm the host, the instructor or whatever, often there's people who come along who are really technically really good and great photographers. And I think it's amazing if they're willing to share their knowledge with the group as well.
Yeah, I think it's fantastic if you can pick up techniques off people that you're working with. And it's amazing how much I know I've learned from people just from doing a few workshops here and there. And you end up finding out a lot more than some of it's a bit about yourself as well.
Totally.
I really enjoy that aspect of it. I'm interested in how you bring your personal expression and your style and your vision into your landscapes. Everyone talks about having a recognizable style, and yours is quite recognizable. How did that develop, and how do you see that developing as you go forward?
Yeah, I think colour would be the word that would describe my style. Like, I'm definitely not one of these people who wants to put a vintage filter on every mountain scene that they come across. And I'm about, we'll embrace the colours that are there in nature. Obviously, there's a point you can take it. I've seen plenty of people who saturate the hell out of their images, and it's like, oh. So it's finding that nice medium, happy ground where you've brought out the potential of that image, but you've not taken it into the completely unbelievable, could never have been that color kind of scenario. And yeah, because I love shooting all types of landscapes. You look through some people's Instagram feeds and it's only mountains, or it's only sunrises or sunsets. Yeah, but I love waterfalls. I love astro. I love aurora when it happens. And so from that point of view, each one of those landscapes has a very different color profile and a very different kind of tonal range and things like that. So being able to just bring those out. And I just think nature is so beautiful. We see, I'm always trying to recreate what I've seen, but just put a little bit of a spin on it that is recognizable as being mine, and just really celebrates the beauty that's out there.
I think one of the things that many people struggle with, you mentioned, that's a key one, and usually a fairly rookie error that many people fall into, because it's very easy to do. And if you don't control how you play with your contrasts and so forth, it can really bend an image out of shape. How much of your work have you put into making sure that you're staying true to the natural scene as much as possible? Because when I look at your work, as you say, it's quite colourful and quite vibrant, but it's also very believable that, yes, I could stand there, I could see that, and in the same conditions, that's what I would see.
Yeah. I think understanding how to use all the different types of colour options available in Lightroom is a really powerful thing. It's very easy just to hit the vibrance or hit the white balance and be done with it. And I look back at my sort of, and I think for a lot of people in their journey of editing, you start from a very low base of knowledge, and then you use the basic panel and you're happy with how that goes. And then you discover presets and you go, oh my God, presets are amazing. Look at what I can do. And often presets will work well for the person who's created the preset on their types of images. And so I look back at some of the images that I still have in my library from, say, 6 or 7 years ago where I might have been using presets, and I go, oh my God, what was I thinking? Like, I look at the editing now and I go, that is just garish and it's horrendous. But at the time, I thought I had done an amazing job. And then I think you reach the top of that preset plateau and then you come down the other side of it and go, hang on a minute, I think I could actually probably get to this as good a result, if not better, if I just understood all the different tools that are available. I really enjoy using the HSL panel just to kind of make individual colours pop, because then you're actually enhancing your skies or your greens in the forest without crucifying the entire image with too much saturation, a bit of colour calibration. I don't use a lot of colour grading. Very occasionally I will. I know a lot of people spend a lot of time cooling down their shadows and warming up their highlights and things, but it's not really my style, so it has to be the right kind of image for me to go, I'm going to use it on this particular shot. So, yeah.
I guess I'm interested in how you have worked with experimentation with new ideas and techniques in the field as opposed to things that you might be doing in post-processing. What sort of inspirations have come to you and said, all right, I'm going to try this? And I guess with experimentation comes failure sometimes. How do you deal with that failure in the event that the experiment hasn't worked?
It feels like my entire astro journey, what you've just said.
Isn't it everybody's astro journey?
I think landscapes can be so incredibly rewarding. If you turn up on a particular morning and you get up for sunrise and you make the effort and you get rewarded with a beautiful light, beautiful scene, and you come up, you know, when you've taken, you've snapped that shot, you know that you've come away with something that you're going to, sometimes I'm hallelujahing at the back of the camera going, oh my gosh, this is so amazing. Astro, on the other hand, is a real exercise in patience and multiple failures. And I don't know if it's just because it's more technical, but also you can't really tell from the back of the camera whether you're going to actually have anything that's going to work until you get it back and start processing it. I've still got a lot to learn with astro, and I do teach it, but to an intermediate level. I look at some of the amazing astro photographers we've got out there, and I'm just not sure if I'm ever going to be willing to put the out like all-nighters in for long periods of time. I've done one all-nighter for astro and it nearly killed me. It took me about 2 weeks to get over it. So for me, trying to maximize my time when I'm out on the field and go, today I'm going to shoot two different images, do some stacking. I don't have a tracker, so I have to stack. Do some stacking and then do a long exposure, go home and hope like hell it works. You know, inevitably there'll be something that was wrong with it that you can't tell because it was dark. And I actually, I can't remember who I was saying this to the other day, but it's the learning and the failures are actually more important than things going right, to be honest. Ultimately, very frustrating if you're just in that one place and you're not planning on going back again anytime soon if you haven't managed to nail the shot. But yeah, I think those are the things that kind of define you, whether you're wanting to go back and try again and do better next time rather than just going, oh, I can't do astro, I'm giving up altogether.
I think anyone should give up necessarily, and not unless they're just never going to put the time and effort into it. But that sense of not giving up is something that I think is really key to success, what do you feel is the key to your success, and what does success look like for you in your photography?
For me, I think I've got some friends who are more talented than me, better photographers, but I think sometimes people can be so hard on themselves and not willing to accept anything less than 100% perfection, like literally sitting there and feeling like, oh, I can't post this on Instagram because it's not perfect, and then they don't post at all. I'm like a bit of the 80-20 rule. If it's 80% there, yeah, okay, it might have a little flaw, but who's gonna know? Better just get it out there and get it into the world than it being absolutely perfect. And I think, like, giving up a secure corporate job to head into a creative field where there's a lot of at risk, basically, I'm the one that has to make my own income. It'd be very easy to get paralyzed with the, I'm not good enough, what if this doesn't work, that kind of thing. But I think, I don't know, my husband would say I'm a realist. He's definitely an optimist. So I'm definitely got a balance of, I can definitely have moments where I'm like, oh, this isn't going so well. But I think for the most part, I'm definitely more a positive, upbeat, positive person. And I think just having to go, just saying, what is the worst that can happen? What, like, if this messes up, what is the worst that can happen? Because if you're constantly thinking about the worst that can happen, then you probably will never do something. You'll just sit at home too scared to leave the house. And I've had some things that haven't been gone as well as I could have, but other things that have gone much better. And I just, for me, success is when I absolutely love running the workshops. I just love getting like-minded people together and just hanging out and making it a real experience for them and helping them improve their skills, but also experiencing the beauty of New Zealand as we do it, which is just as important. And for me, success is getting to the end of the workshop and people being absolutely buzzing, who've maybe just haven't picked up their camera much and are now just completely inspired to get out there and try some new things. And I'm definitely not going to have taught them all I know, but even if I've just done a little bit of a step in their journey along the way, then yeah, I just, that makes me so happy.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do you like to shoot with other people more than shooting alone, or is it a bit of a mix?
Bit of a mix. It tends to be very cyclical. So obviously on workshops, I won't even shoot a sunrise if I'm busy helping people or whatever. And there's people at different stages of their learning, and some people need a lot more help, especially on the first few days of a workshop. As a workshop progresses, people tend to like increase in confidence. Mm-hmm. So from that point of view, yeah, there's different. But I also like to walk up and down and just get people excited about what they're seeing, and because I'm always excited, so I like to bring people along on the ride with me. But yeah, I also love those times when I do have moments to myself, because those are the ones where you just know it's just between you and God or you and nature, and they're pretty special too. I think being a woman in photography, there's always you're less inclined to do a lot of solo. Some people are into it. I still have a healthy sense of not necessarily wanting to push the boundaries of what is safe in terms of being out by myself. So often I'll enjoy having it when it's just me and one other person, which is, I've got a friend I do a lot of trips with and we think the same, love the same type of photography. So I feel very lucky to have her. But yeah, I enjoy all kinds of it. I get something different from each type of scenario. For myself, it's just that whole, I saw this, it was just for me, it's just for me to remember, or something that's shared is something that you'll always go back to, that, oh, do you remember when we did this? And you know, it's a cool shared experience.
Yeah, sure. I'd like to move on to the lifestyle choice of going full-time. How difficult was it to make that choice, and how did you go about it? What thought processes were going on when you made the decision?
Yeah, so I was working full-time as an accountant, but working in a family business. So I was quite lucky that I had a very honest heart-to-heart with my brother and said, look, I really would love to give this photography thing a go. I'll never know if I don't do it. I kept saying, everyone said, oh, you should totally go full-time and be a full-time photographer. And I just used to keep saying, the accounting pays the bills, it pays the mortgage, maybe in 10 years' time. I've been saying this for about 3 or 4 years, and I thought, God, this is such a terrible excuse to not follow my dreams. Like, really? In 10 years' time, I'm going to be that much older, and the joints are going to be creakier, and will I really then want to be doing something? So I was just like, no, I've just got to give it a go. I was very lucky that I was able to phase myself out of the business that I was working in, so I dropped gradually. And then when COVID hit, luckily, I was still working 3 days a week then, so I was able to continue some work for the business whilst I started building up mine. At that time, I was actually quite lucky that I was contacted by Case Filters. So I've been ambassador and also the distributor here in New Zealand for sort of 3 and a bit years. So that was really awesome, because it's been a really good another feather in my bow in terms of people. Often people haven't discovered filters, they discover filters and then they decide to come on a workshop, or vice versa. Yep. They come on a workshop and then they go, oh, filters are amazing, I want to get some. So that for me, that's been a real help, and it was also a real good basis. I had to build the business up, of course, but that was great just in that it was underpinned some of the other cyclical work, which is a bit seasonal and only happens when I choose to run a workshop, for example.
Yeah. What does a workshop with Meghan Maloney look like?
Oh, it depends. So I will usually do a range throughout the year, and I try and run different workshops in different places around New Zealand so that I'm not going always going back to the same place. I think you've had a podcast with Rachel Gillespie before. So we always run one or two together a year. So we usually run one in Mackenzie in autumn, which is usually four days, three nights. And then I will normally have a couple of others that are 4 days, 3 nights. And then I normally try and do one longer one during the winter, which next year is solely based on the West Coast. But yeah, I think I get people who come back regularly, and I think that's because A, they enjoy them, but they're like, oh, I haven't been there, and this year Megan's going there, so I'm going to go there. So that's been really awesome. And I guess for me, the one good thing about COVID was that we had a lot of Kiwis here in the country with cameras who couldn't travel, who wanted to learn how to be better photographers. So there was no lack of clientele in a way, even though we had no international travelers, because Kiwis actually just wanted to get out there and see the country. Sure. And learn.
Probably good for them too, getting out there without all the international tourists around.
Yeah, I have to say it's been quite noticeable this year. I think it was our autumn workshop this year. We went into Araki for the day, and just at that White Horse Hill car park, which is like the main car park where you do the walk to Hooker Lake. And I, even pre-COVID, I had never seen it that busy. There were cars lined up all the way down the road, not even like the car park was full to overflowing. And I was like, wow, this is what it's like to have tourists back again. I was quite shocked, actually. And I'm certainly not anti the tourism industry. It's a very important part of our economy. And I don't mind having them here, and I just might want to have to share spots with people first thing in the morning. When I say that, though, we're still incredibly lucky. Apart from perhaps the Wanaka tree, you're really not going to have to fight and jostle.
You're not shoulder to shoulder with it.
No, I'm actually headed off to Iceland in March, and I'm already trying to psych myself up for the fact that it's not going to be like it is here in New Zealand, and there's probably going to be some shoulder to shoulder. I'll just get really good at just need to improve my shoulder muscles so I can barge people out of the way.
I'm interested in people's personal brand and the wearing of the many hats that you have to wear. Your background in accounting is obviously going to be an advantage in some of those aspects, but how do you deal with the marketing side? And how, a lot of photographers are introverted and therefore don't like spruiking their work and talking about themselves, etc. How important is it to get out there and get your name out?
Oh, super important. But yeah, if you're a highly introverted person, it just makes it that much harder. So I'm a Sony ambassador here in New Zealand, and so part of my role here is to run about 7 or 8 events a year. Some of those are online through Zoom, some of those are in person. And I also talk at a lot of camera clubs, and that often leads people to then book on workshops with me. I've always enjoyed public speaking. You know, I used to like doing speeches and stuff at school. So I guess that's been an advantage from that point of view. I still get nervous when I have to stand up in front of people, but I actually really, afterwards, I'm always quite buoyed and amped by the experience. And then in terms of the marketing, so I do a lot of it myself in terms of the, so for the filters, I'm often like doing ads for sales and things like that. And I've been on Instagram and Facebook a really long time, back from when everybody, it was growth city and you could get 1,000 new followers a day pretty much. But I do have a couple of people, external people who help me. I've got someone who helps me with my Facebook ads because they're the experts in that field. And I've got someone who helps me with Google ads as well. So I think it's really easy to think, oh, I'll just do it on myself. How hard can it be? But actually, if you've got people who are experts at what they do, they're going to be, it's going to be more beneficial in terms of getting the right SEO and the right traffic to your site and things like that. And so yes, you might have to pay for the privilege, but you actually reap the rewards from doing that and using people who are, that's what they do all day, every day. It's only part of what I do. The odd Instagram post, I'm not definitely no Instagram guru. And so why not use people who actually can get you the results that you want?
Yeah. Okay. That's great advice. What do you think is your biggest challenge in balancing work, photography, workshops, and family?
Oh, don't even get me started. Both my boys play football at a really, this is soccer, play football at a really high level. So last year, from sort of April through till September, and my husband was playing too when he didn't have a broken arm, we had 5 games of football a weekend and I think 4 practices a week. And so I'm away quite a lot between April to September. So I find it really hard to miss those moments because I know that they aren't going to be, the kids aren't going to be at home forever. I hate missing any games, but I just have to resign myself to the fact that the profession I've chosen requires me to potentially be away almost every other weekend through that same time. So I just try and make the most of being mum taxi service during the week because I'm often away on weekends and things as well. So, and any game I can get to is a bonus. And that's why, like recently, I actually went over to Melbourne when my youngest played in a tournament. Because I didn't get to do all of that stuff during the year for the games, it was really important for me to actually set that time aside and go, no, I'm going to come and support you in that. So, yeah, they're pretty understanding, I have to say. Now, they're at an age where they know that this is what I do and what I love, and they can really look after themselves. And it's not even as if hubby needs to be home now because they're pretty independent. But yeah, it's just about taking those moments when we do have them. We've booked to walk the Kepler track in April as a family with a couple of friends, and it might not be exactly their idea of a really happening fun time, but I know that they'll appreciate it afterwards, that we've got this family memory together, all of us. And yeah, I think it's just about all those little moments that you do have, making the most of them, so that when I am away for long stretches of time, it's not, mum, who are you? It is a juggle, and it's always something I think I will always struggle with, because I know a lot of people who have families and they're never home and they travel overseas all the time, and I enjoy the travel, but I absolutely love coming home and being at home. So I love both of those parts of my life equally, which I guess is a good thing, because I look forward to being away, but I really look forward to coming home.
Nice. One thing a lot of people struggle with is pricing of their work. How do you work out how to price what you're doing?
That is a very good question. And you know what? I get a lot of people asking me for advice on Instagram about this as well, because they might have just been asked by someone for the first time. A commercial.
I go and do a shoot for an event or something like that.
Yeah. So and so, this particular council, this particular tourism board wants some images. How should I price it? And I normally just, I never will just give them a number, and I would say, look, tell me a little bit more about the project. What are they asking for? What are the rights involved? How long do they want it for? How many images do they want? What would you realistically be happy with too? And a lot of people will probably price themselves too low. And I've got to say, you've got to value the work that you do and not undersell yourself too, because once if you set a precedent that's too low, then it's very hard to. And I think over time I've definitely increased my pricing. I think doing a lot of online, there used to be, what it's called now, I don't think it actually works anymore, but there was an online digital imaging calculator.
Yeah.
One, maybe?
I think so. Yeah. I remember using it a couple of times. Yeah.
So that sort of thing is, I think their ballpark was like probably 3 or 4 times more than what you'd realistically be able to ask for here in New Zealand. But at least gave you something to work to. Yeah. And often, there's definitely work I don't get because I'll say, this is my price. And people will go, oh, but we're just a charity and we can't afford blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, and I've already discounted it anyway, knowing that there might be a not-for-profit.
Sure.
And so I guess you just have to be, you have to price it at a point where you're happy that if they walk away, you feel like you've not overpriced it, but you've not undervalued your work either. Because there's times I really want to write that big, long email back that says things like, so if you knew how many thousands of dollars I have invested in my gear and the petrol it took me to drive to this place or fly to this place and drive to this place that's 1,000 kilometers away and I was
and
there
the accommodation
for 5 years. All of that sort of stuff. But yeah, unfortunately, us photographers, somewhat undervalued as a whole, I think, unfortunately.
I love the we'll pay you with exposure attempts that...
the problem is that actually people are younger in their journeys, and they love that idea. So, unfortunately, I've got to the point where I have to politely say, unfortunately, exposure doesn't feed my children.
That's it.
In a nice way.
One of the things that is always interesting to me is the nexus between where you live, where you like to shoot, what you shoot, but also how you shoot and whether or not any of those elements influences the other, particularly around how you shoot.
Yeah. So unfortunately, I live in the North Island and my favourite places are a plane ride away. So that's where I spend a lot of the sort of autumn, winter, spring away. The Waikato is great. I love living here. It's very green, rolling hills. Sometimes I look at the shots I have from the Waikato and feel like I've done the place to death and there's nowhere else to shoot, which is completely stupid because I know that there are other places I haven't discovered yet. And I've got my favourites I keep going back to. But yeah, I'm a sucker for mountains and lakes. And I guess the one thing I do enjoy up here is shooting beaches and waterfalls. Whereas when I'm down south, it's more about chasing the mountains and the lakes, that kind of thing. So it's good to live somewhere where you've got one type of thing for the summer and that, and then to be able to do all the travel in the winter. Yeah, as I said, I would love to be able to get out more and do more kind of, you know, off the remoter adventures. Mm-hmm. But I've also got to be realistic in that I'm 40 something, moderately fit. No, I mean, I'm okay, but I'm not someone who could hike with 25 kilos, go into a remote hut that's 3 days walk away just to get a shot. I just can't do that. It's just not me. I want to be able to do it. The mind is willing, the body is not. So with that in mind, I always have to try and structure adventures that feel like they're at the limit of where I'm comfortable at. It's going to push me physically and allow me a little bit mentally to get there. You know, enjoy the reward and enjoy the experience, but not be so stupid to think that I can do something that I can't. Just have to be realistic.
Yeah, anything that involves ice climbing is completely out. So what is your favourite spot? You mentioned Waikato. Is there a spot that just keeps calling you back in that area or any other area for that matter?
Yeah, like I said, if you gave me a no budget, no issues, no travel, no time restrictions, you can go shoot, I'll be in the South Island like in 5 minutes. So there's just no argument there. But I love Araki area and I love Fiordland. Those are probably my two favorites, and I can keep going back to those and never feel like I've done the place to death. I've still got some unfinished business with some astro at Hooker Lake, and I haven't been to Dusky Sound, although one of my workshops next year, I've hopefully got a helicopter flight getting into Dusky, so that'll be cool to see that. Right. There's this year in August trip, August trip with my friend, we actually got up to Chancellor Hut, which is above Fox Glacier. We helied up there, got a little bit more than we bargained for, because when we turned up to check in for the heli flight, the guys said, so hopefully you are aware of the fact there's probably going to be thigh-deep snow up there. And we were like, Yeah, no, we weren't really prepared for that. So after they dropped us off and you couldn't even see the steps down to the hut, and we were dragging our packs and our photography gear through, just like crunching through this super deep snow, we just looked at each other and went, what the hell have we done? Because we're up here for the night. There's no heating in the hut. There's a radio, so you can radio in the next morning or if anything happened.
Sure.
But yeah, it was certainly a little bit more of an adventure than we'd planned. In some ways, it was the shots we got were awesome. We did some astro in that as well. But it was also quite hard to move around in that much snow. Even getting 100 metres back behind the hut to get the hut in the shot for sunset was like 20 minutes of like literally cutting steps into the snow. But ones like that I will remember forever, and they're often the ones where you get more of an adventure than you planned for. So yeah, I've got too many places to have a favourite, but Araki, Fiordland, probably Nugget Point for lighthouse and sort of coastal. I've been there, like I said, it's probably about as far away from home as I can get in New Zealand. I've been there something like 6 or 7 times in about 8 years. And then also Lake Matheson on the west coast is a bit of a fave too. But yeah, I think a lot of the time I get inspired by seeing adventures other people have done and go, oh, I want to put that on my bucket list. This year I finally got to Lake Danielle, which is in the Lewis Pass. Been trying to do an overnight hike there for about 2 winters, and just the weather was never any good. This time we finally got, actually the last trip we did, we actually managed to tick off quite a few things that we have on a joint bucket list of places we wanted to go. Did involve driving ridiculous distances to do it, but that's pretty much par for the course when you're chasing landscapes.
Is there a spot that you'd like to retire at that you've shot at?
Yeah, I think, I'm not sure my husband agrees with this because he quite likes where we live, but I would probably, the two places in the country or down in the South Island that I would choose to live is Twizel or Te Anau. And that's just not because of the towns themselves, but it's the proximity to all of the scenery. The fact that you can live in Twizel and be 40 minutes up to Araki Mount Cook, the fact that you're in Te Anau and you can be in Milford Sound in an hour, both of those places appeal for different reasons. So I feel like there will be a South Island stint in my future, possibly not for another 10 or 15 years, but yeah, definitely at some point I would like to actually just be there for a good 2 or 3 years at least, and just see all the seasons, because I'm dipping in and dipping out on a weekend, but I'm not necessarily getting to experience all that there is good about it. Although I know Twizel often suffers through weeks of poor frost and fog and people get very depressed, so I'll have to just think about that one a little bit more.
Sounds marvelous though. What's your most memorable experience out shooting?
Oh goodness, that is tough. There's been so many. I think one of the ones I always come back to is an overnight up at the Puakaitan in Taranaki, and we walked up after dark. So I don't necessarily love hiking in the dark, but it was like a 2.5 hour hike up some steps in the dark. Stayed the night and got a really beautiful golden light at sunrise, which was an image that then was in the Sony Alpha Awards for landscape category in 2018. And I was really lucky that this was pre-COVID, and so they were still having an event. And the images were on display in Sydney in this warehouse, large, like 2.25-meter canvas. And they said afterwards, do you want that image? And I was like, yeah, I don't know where I'll put it. I don't even think I've got a wall big enough in my house for it, but yeah, I'll have it, of course. And actually, we've since built a new house, and I've made an entranceway that was exactly the right size for that canvas. But I think for me, the reason that one is so memorable is that, like, you've put the hard yards and you've driven 3 hours and you've walked up in the dark and you've got up in the morning and seen this beautiful scene. But also the where was important to me, because both sides of my family are from Taranaki, and my granddad had climbed Taranaki multiple times. My dad's climbed it a lot too. And so to have an image from there that was so, and it was a couple of years after I'd lost my last grandparent. They all lived in Taranaki. So the fact that I've now got that, and it's actually the only image of my photography that I have on in our house at all at the moment. I've got a frame TV that's got some other images that go round and round on a slideshow. But that one is, I think, will always be super special to me, A, because it was like a bit of a starting point in Sony becoming aware of me. And so that kind of obviously led into the ambassadorship eventually.
Sure.
But also the fact that it was from a region where I've never lived in Taranaki, but all my life we went there for holidays and spent time with the grandparents, and my dad took us hiking up on the mountain. And so for me, it doesn't probably really matter where I live or in the country, Taranaki will always feel like where my roots are, where I'm from. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. What about horror stories?
Things like what? Forgetting to take your lens off of manual after an astro shoot and shooting a beautiful sunrise and realizing that everything is out of focus when you get home.
Yeah, I've done that a few times.
Yeah. Probably one of the harder, and it's not so much a horror story, but just a hard yakka stories. I walked the root burn with my husband in 2019. Mm-hmm. So I've done the root burn and the Milford. So we're doing the Kepler, as I said, this coming year. And I didn't do the right kind of hiking for the elevation. I just thought putting my pack on my back and walking around Cambridge, around the river, and doing a bit of elevation would be enough for the amount of up and down we were doing. And it really wasn't. And I was actually in a really bad way after the first day. And I'd done like, of the 32 kilometers I'd done, we did a bit extra because we went up to Key Summit, but pretty much was crippled by the time I got to the hut. And I just remember saying to my husband, I actually don't think I can do this. I just don't know how I'm going to walk these next 2 days. And he said something, and he'll probably kill me for saying this, but he said something like, I'm not effing helicoptering you out of here, so you're just going to have to suck it up. But again, so the next day, first half of the second day was uphill, and that was fine. But I was, to the point, I had walking poles as well, so it wasn't like I was without those. But the second half of the second day was all downhill, and the third day was all downhill. And the downhill was what was killing the backs of my knees. And we were not that far from the Rootburn hut, and my hubby was walking behind me, and I was basically stiff-legged. And I don't know if you've watched There's Something About Mary, you've got Cameron Diaz as the main character, and then she's got that guy with the glasses, and he walks funny, like basically stiff-legged. And he was likening me to, I think his name's Tucker in the movie, and he was taking the mickey out of me on the GoPro, and I was so miserable, and I was just like, I can't believe you're making fun of how absolutely miserable I am right now. And then to the point where when we got to the Rootburn hut, there's a helicopter pad, which has got a beautiful view of the valley, and I dragged myself up there using my tripod as a kind of a walking pole for sunset and got some nice pastel colours. And then the next morning, I was going to the toilet like super early, and I could see this crazy red glow in the sky. And I hadn't really planned to get up for sunrise, but I was like, oh my gosh. And I was trying to make not much noise because everyone else in the hut's still asleep. And I grabbed my camera, grabbed the tripod, and almost crawled my way back up to the helicopter pad because I was so stiff. And I'm sitting there and I've got myself all set up and I can tell it's going to be amazing. And then I look at my camera and it's like on 2% battery. And I'm like, anyway, luckily for me, I think my husband had heard me get up. So he appeared and on the balcony, and I just yelled at him like I was probably about 300-400 meters away. I was just like, I need a battery. Anyway, he arrived up about 3 or 4 minutes later with a battery and saved the day, and I managed to get my sunrise. And then I just basically had to crawl / hobble the last 8 kilometers out. Yeah, it was one of those worst 3 days of my life, but the scenery itself was epic. And ever since then, I've had a bit of a phobia about getting myself into a position where I can't walk out of somewhere. So I probably overtrain for things now because I just never want to go through that kind of experience again. Photography, I tell you.
I think you might actually make a really good point there about the preparation. And a lot of people, I think, when they go out into, and it doesn't even have to be actual real wilderness, but even just some of the people I see walking around national parks. I saw a guy up in Queensland, and only a couple of k's walk, so it wasn't a big walk. It was a nice path and everything, except leeches everywhere. And he's walking down the track with his tent and everything on his back, so he's obviously going to go down and camp somewhere down there. But he's walking in sandals without any kind of other protection. And we picked him up before he got to the area where the leeches were. And I said, you might want to change your shoes. And he said, no, I'll be right. Okay.
At least you feel like you've done your part. As stupid does, sometimes you can only provide advice. You can't change people's minds completely. We have that happen all the time here in New Zealand, the Tongariro Alpine Crossing here, which is a one day. People are forever getting rescued off of that because they just don't understand the risks. They don't understand that it's...
Even just not taking enough water, even just on a short walk. It just blows my mind that people don't think about that stuff before they set off.
Yeah.
What have you learned about the world through photography?
Oh, I've learned that it's a very big place and there's a lot of places I want to see, and I'm probably not going to see them all in the time I have left. So I have to prioritize. Yeah. And I think, like, as a young person, I lived in London for 3 years and I traveled a little bit in Europe, and I loved going to all the cities and exploring and seeing all of that kind of thing. But the older I get, the more I become like a hermit, and that I just want to visit all the places where there are no people. Like, I don't mind the odd person. I love striking up conversations with randoms that I meet when I'm out shooting. But me and a couple of other people, that's cool. Me and 50 million people all in the same spot, not so much. So I'm just going to try and spend the rest of my days trying to experience places where the scenery is jaw-dropping and I can feel at one with nature and closer to God. And the Dolomites is another big one, which is on my hit list after Iceland. And the Iceland trip's been a long time coming, and I feel like I should have done it about eight years ago, probably, before it got as popular as it is now. But it's still going to be pretty epic. And when I get home from an adventure, I have to plan another adventure. Like, the first thing I do within a day or two of getting back from something is, what is next? What can I book? Where am I going to go? It doesn't matter if I have to wait 2 years to go and do that thing. I just always have to have that thing to look forward to. Yeah. And I think that generally gets you through the mundane day to day, the kids forgetting their lunch, the dog eating their homework, whatever. All of those day-to-day things, so long as you've got that thing to attain for, to look forward to, can get you through a lot of just the mundane day-to-day where things aren't as exciting. Yeah.
Absolutely. And what do you do when you're getting back from a shoot? You drop the bags, put the card into the computer, get everything loaded up and start editing? Or do you let it sit for a while and it just sits there and you get to it later?
Yeah, to be honest, the more I've been out, the more I've run workshops and the more I've been out traveling, the worse I've got at this. Part of that is because on my camera, I can connect into my phone. So quite often what I'll do is I'll look on the back of my camera at what I think are my favorite images, drop them onto my phone, do a quick little edit in Lightroom Mobile. That's generally what you'll see on my stories. It's not raw files. That's just the, hey, I was here this morning, this is beautiful, blah, blah, blah. So the downside with that is that you kind of feel like you've done editing when you really haven't at all. And so often I will come back from a shoot and I'll be about to go out somewhere and I'll go look at my memory card and go, oh my God, I haven't even downloaded my images from 3 weeks ago. How bad is that? And if you saw my Lightroom image library, you'd be horrified at how many unedited images I have from the last few years. I'm trying to do a big cull, but I never seem to catch up on myself. I think what makes it worse is as you become slightly more technically proficient and you're doing things like panoramas and exposure bracketing and focus stacking, you don't just come home with 10 of your favorite images from a shoot. It's 10 times 10 because you've done all these other things that you then have to go back and edit. So that just adds to the noise of how much there is to do when you get back. I generally will try, and the images that I've probably liked on my phone or done a quick edit on my phone, those are generally the first ones I'll go to in my Lightroom because they sit side by side. The JPEG that's been edited syncs. So then when I look at that raw file, it's usually a good starting point. But yeah, I have been known to find images that I was like, oh, I didn't even know I had this, which is not a very good workflow. I always say to my workshop attendees, do as I do as I say and not as I
do.
Yeah. Look, I work off of collections in Lightroom, and that works for me quite well. So I have like regional collections, but also client collections, trip collections. And so I can actually find stuff, and I have a lot of it synced to my phone, so I can find stuff super quick. But in the background there is absolute chaos, which no one ever gets to see. I just sits in the back of my brain gnawing at me going, you've still got 15,000 images to edit from this year.
What are you doing talking to me then?
Totally. It is one of my to-do lists for the summer, is to cull my library a bit.
Fantastic. How did you, obviously not the chaos side of things, but how did you learn your processing and your photography? And one of the things I'm really interested in understanding is whether or not you shoot for how you edit, or whether you edit for how you shoot, which drives the other.
I think I shoot just how I see, and the editing is how I feel when I come to look at a shot.
That's a great answer. I love that.
Yeah. Because I know for a fact that I have sometimes come back to an image a year later and I've edited it completely differently.
Yep.
You know, because I feel differently at the time, and maybe my skills have changed, maybe Lightroom's done an update and the masking is better or whatever, which has happened. In fact, yesterday I was playing with an image from Kate Reunga, which I took back in 2019. And it's an image I've always really loved. It was golden hour. The lighthouse is bathed in light and there's these beautiful golden clouds, the grass looks great, and there's a whole ton of people in that shot. Someone's pointing at there's like a sign that tells you how far away you are in the world from a bunch of places, and there's probably about four or five groups of people in that shot. And I've just always been, I can't do anything with the shot. I love the shot, so I've never deleted it, but I was like, I can't do anything with the shot because it's just too many people. Cloning doesn't work. Even the content aware in Photoshop's not the greatest. Enter AI. I tell you, honestly, I did it yesterday. It took me 3 or 4 minutes and I was like, holy moly, you would never know there was people in that shot now. And I know we don't need to get into the whole AI thing, but if for nothing else, I love the changes that have been made this year, because it's just meant that I was standing in Rotorua during the year, big long path with these trees on either side, and it's about a 500 meter, if not a kilometer path. The chances of getting a shot without anyone on that path ever, doesn't matter whether you're there at 7 a.m., 7 p.m., midday, it's quite rare. And so in the end, when I was on this workshop, I just took a shot. But it did such a good job of getting rid of the people and making it look like it was just a beautiful landscape. And so, yeah, I feel like I maybe got digressed a little bit there. Edit for the shoot, no. I think I just shoot what I see and hope that when I get back, I can recreate what I saw with my eyes. And that might look different today than what it would do if I edited the same shot in a year's time.
Yeah, sure. What about where the learning came from? Was it something that you went out? That's all right. I'd almost forgotten as well.
All self-taught, pretty much. Learned off of other people, learned off of YouTube. I do try and, as soon as the updates come out in Lightroom, I always try and watch the tutorials and see what's new and how to use it and things like that. So I should try and be a bit of ahead of the game there. But yeah, I have watched there's a few people who I really enjoy watching on YouTube that I will watch from time to time. But most of it is just self-taught and just making mistakes and learning from those and going back and refining down the track. I think it's really important, no matter how skilled a photographer you are, to always go back and revisit some of your older work and see if, like I said, with that image with the removing the people from the lighthouse, you've probably got stuff that's traditionally quite good that might have been something that you couldn't quite get right at the time, that with the knowledge you have now, it's worth revisiting.
Yeah. Everyone occasionally comes up with those times when they're not feeling their photography. How do you deal with those times and overcome the challenges of not wanting to go out, or not wanting to edit, or not wanting to do something in your photography? How do you pull yourself out of the rut and say, all right, Meghan, back on the horse, we've got to get going?
I think because because I have, like I said, it's quite a cyclical, my year's quite cyclical. And so I've got periods of the year where I'm doing a lot of photography and periods like now where I'm not doing a lot of photography. Like I haven't, trying to think, what did I did? I ran a little event on the 11th of November. So what's that? Like over a month ago. And that's probably the last time I did any kind of landscape photography. I'm shooting a wedding on next Friday, which I do a couple of times a year just to keep my hand in something, a different genre. But I think it's important not to force yourself, because I think the more you try and force yourself to get out of a rut, the worse you can make it. Like just actually being kind enough to yourself to go, okay, you really know you should be out there shooting astro right now because it's clear skies, it's calm, you get a good shot. But I'm like, oh, it's really warm on the couch and my cup of tea is so much more appealing. And just not, I guess, not forcing yourself, because at the end of the day, if you do it and you're out there and you're not loving it, then you're probably just going to make it worse. So I think just generally leaning into it and going, okay, I'm not feeling it right now. I'm probably tired. I've probably been doing too much. I'm just going to give it a break and not push it. And yeah, generally I feel like it just comes right by itself. But I think, yeah, I think sometimes if you try to force your way through it by just keep doing more and more of the same, you're probably only going to make it worse.
Yeah.
Sometimes a changes or just a break can be all you need just to reset.
What do you see as the biggest challenge facing photographers right now?
Oh, I wouldn't be. I think most people would say AI if they were.
It's quite common, yeah.
Yeah, definitely the AI side of things. Although I'm probably being naive when I say this, but I feel like people buy prints and canvases off of me because they know that I've been there and done that and taken that shot.
Yeah.
I've dabbled a little bit on Midjourney and Firefly and trying to basically get it to recreate classic scenes of mine, like that one I was talking about at the Puakaitan and Mount Taranaki. I've given it all the parameters and said, create me this image. It doesn't look like Mount Taranaki for a start, although possibly it will get better at that kind of thing. So I shouldn't
rely if it on... consumes enough images of Mount Taranaki, it'll eventually get
eventually
there.
Yeah, but yeah, I think and I think a lot of the time I always try and have, like with my calendar this year, I've told the stories behind all the shots and on a double page spread. And I think people often will want to be part of your life, your world, of your photography because of the shared experience they like to live vicariously through you. And I think AI will never replace that. And also, for me, because workshops are such a big part of what I do, a robot's not going to be able to engage with people, I would hope, the same way that I can. And
not for a while, anyway.
Not for a while. Maybe not in our lifetime, hopefully. That can't change that experience, that personal sort of element to it. I do think for photography as a whole, there's probably some genres that are looking really risky with AI coming on, product photography and things like that. So I'd be much more worried if I was just a commercial photographer taking photos of beer bottles with lovely glistening.
I think events and weddings, they're fairly safe.
Yeah. But
yeah, I think you're right. The product photography and fashion, I think it's already started to bleed there as marketing departments realise, oh, I can do this myself.
Yeah.
Just by typing a few words. What do you think the future of photography holds for us?
The thing is, no matter where we end up with AI, and I don't think any of us, no matter how smart we think we are, I don't think any of us can really see where it's going to lead. We just have to try and not bury our heads in the sand and actually use it to our advantage. I'm not suggesting we sky replace all our images. I'm not suggesting we should be creating stuff that's not there, but I think for removing people out of an image, I'm all about it. I think we just have to bear in mind that people are always going to want to travel. They're always going to want to take images in beautiful places for their own personal experience and what that moment meant to them. Or they want to buy a print off of me because they've seen an image from a place they went. Like just recently I had a girl in Australia buy an image. It is an old image of mine too, but it's because she got proposed to at that spot. And it's got memories for her. So you can't really take that away from from the photography. And I think, and even though maybe in, I don't know, 20 years time, our phones will probably be able to do as good a job as our cameras, there's still some level of skill in the post-processing process that a lot of people aren't really willing to put the time and energy in to learn. They're just happy to do their little snaps on their phone and be done with it. For me, I actually enjoy the editing as much as I enjoy the experience of being out in the field. So I think that's where, for photographers, if you've got a well-rounded kind of approach where you like the experience, but you also want to maximize in post-processing, creating something of art, then there'll always be a role for us landscape photographers. I hope. Absolutely. That's where I'd like us to end up, whether it is true or not. But I think we just have to be open-minded, and it's too easy to go, oh, it's not going to happen to me, or I'm not even going to think about AI. I don't want to know anything about it. But you're forewarned is forearmed. You know?
Absolutely. You mentioned your experience early on with Instagram and social media. Having been using those tools for so long, where do you see their place in the future of photography? Do you see them sticking around, and do you see them making it worse than they already have, or do you see them making it better? For me, it's definitely a double-edged sword. You need it to get your work out there, but it can also be very imposing for somebody just starting out, particularly now, and particularly the way the algorithms are skewed towards video, etc.
Yeah, it's a real tricky one, and I guess I'm very grateful that I started at the point that I did, so that I have a few years of using the tool and having a okay number of followers and things in the background. I can't see a day where Instagram doesn't exist, because it is one of the big, maybe it's just because it's the one I use. And I, same with Facebook, but it's, and who knows, we don't know what we don't know. We don't know what's not out there at the moment. It'd be great if there could be like one sort of platform to rule them all, where it was good for every kind of, good for the video, good for the photos, good for catching up with the family or whatever it is you want to do. But yeah, I think competition won't let that happen, to be honest. Yeah, I think if you're just starting out, I say to people, because I do have a course on getting started selling your photography online, the one thing that people often overlook is the benefit of having your own website, and you own that website. So if something happens to Facebook, if something happens to Instagram, you still have your IP somewhere on the internet getting traffic, etc. So solely being so single-minded and that you only focus on one platform is pretty risky, because you don't own Instagram, so anything can happen. But I don't want it to happen, because I've really enjoyed my years on Instagram, and as much as people go on about it, I can't really fault how it's helped my business grow. So from that point of view, I'm always going to be quite grateful for that. But yeah, I think getting your own site out there in the world and always driving stuff back to there rather than just to Instagram for the sake of it is always going to be where people should be putting their best of their endeavors. Instagram is just a window through to more.
Yeah. Who do you think I should be talking to on the podcast?
Oh, I don't know who you have talked to, Grant. I probably say lots of names of people you've already had on there.
Give it a go. We'll see how we go.
Are you just doing Kiwi Aussie, or just in anybody anywhere?
No, I've been global. I've done Canadians. I've done someone from Turkey. I'm trying to line up some people from Scandinavia as well. So yeah, it's landscape photography world for a reason.
Totally. I'm a quite a big fan of Nigel Danson.
Yep.
And Mads Peter Iverson. I have to say, his work and his guides to Iceland have been invaluable for me in planning my trip. I think I really resonate with people who were really free and willing to share information, because not all landscape photographers are like that. You can find people who are hold their cards close to their chest. They want to keep all the what they know for themselves. And I'm just like, no, I want to get it all out there in the world. And the more people learn, the more people know, the better. So I think that's probably why their work resonates with me. Yeah, I'm a big fan of those too. And yeah, closer to home. You've probably interviewed everybody I already know in New Zealand.
I still think there's a few.
Oh, yeah, probably. I can't think of anyone off the top of my head, though. That's the thing. I'm like putting me on the spot here. No, I can't think. Maybe offline I'll have to send you a message.
No worries. That'll be fine. I've got one more question for you as we wrap up. And for many of my listeners, it's the most important one I ask. Do you like pineapple on pizza?
Yes, I'm a big fan of Hawaiian.
Okay.
I think I probably like it. Probably like a meat lover's more than Hawaiian, but I definitely don't pick the pineapple off.
Yeah, I don't order it, but if it's there, it stays on the pizza and I eat it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny how things can be so polarizing.
Absolutely. That's why I asked the question, because I think the landscape photography community needs to know.
Definitely.
Thank you very much for spending some time with us, Meghan. It's been wonderful getting to know you. Where can people find your work?
Well, obviously, I've mentioned a few places. I'm on Instagram and Facebook. If you just do at Meghan Maloney Photography, and I've got a website which is the same, meghanmaloneyphotography.co.nz. I say this now, I'm like, I should have really come up with a nice moniker, which was a lot shorter than that, because by the time you've typed all that in, it's quite the mouthful.
Well, you should try Grant Swinburne Photography.
Oh, you and I, if we counted the number of letters, we're probably almost the same, I would suggest.
It'd be pretty close, I reckon.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the opportunity, Grant. Lovely to chat.
Pleasure. Thanks again for listening to Landscape Photography World. I hope you enjoyed the show, and keep listening because I'll be joined by some great guests in upcoming episodes. You can find my work in this podcast at grantswinburnephotography.com. I'm also on Vero, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook. I'm Grant Swinburne. Hope to see you out shooting soon. Mm-hmm.